Hey, how's it going, everybody? So I wanted to share on YouTube tonight my very first meeting with my family and the Truro Police with Search and Rescue Colchester. Now, if you listen very closely to what they say in this recording, and then go back and listen to W5 News and what they said in that, then you can understand the lies. And the being untruthful, which I disagree when it comes to a little boy. I think all people, all human beings deserve to know exactly what took place that day, what was done that day, what was used, the mapping, what failed, what was successful. None of this sliding in under the rug. Here's that recording. After listening to the recording, comment below on my YouTube what you've picked out from a lie between W5 News and this recording from the very first meeting I've ever had with law enforcement and search and rescue. If you would like to follow me, please hit the subscribe button. I can use everybody's help and support. Let's bring Dylan home.
I'd like to first say, well, I'm Norman. I'm Ashley's dad, Dylan's grandfather.
I'm Kathy, Jason's sister.
I'm Rob Hearn. I'm the deputy chief, and I see for most of the search. Okay, for this.
We met you the other day.
Yes, and I'm Tom Fitzpatrick. I'm the plans chief of Colchester Ground Search and Rescue up the road.
Okay.
I mean, he answered that actually was the search manager for the search, except for when Halifax was on site.
I'm Dave, the chief. I've been all in the last little while.
I'm Monty Emery, detective with the Truro Police Service. I'll be the lead investigator.
Inspector Smith, I can look after the patrol section. So what we want to do this morning, we're going to turn it over to Ground Search and Rescue first for about 15 minutes. So we're going to give you guys an update on absolutely everything that was searched, every technique that they used, and kind of where we are today on what they have to do in the next couple of days, some things that they want to try. And then we'll talk about where we're going to transition from the search to the missing persons file and from Monty's side of the house, right? So that's what we're hoping to accomplish this morning. Entertain any questions that you have, and so this is your time to get some answers, and we want to be as open as we can and share as much information as we can with you folks, right? And that's Jason's here. So everyone knows that Jason's recording the session, just so you know. Not that it's going to impact what you say or whatever, but just be so you all know that. So anyway, I'll turn it over to Ground Search folks. Away we go.
Okay. So when we got the call, we came in, we set up. Our first priority, according to one of the things we look at heavily when we're doing any type of a search, is our lost person behavior statistics. Because there's statistics from around the world. And one of the first statistics I saw was that 50% of lost children in an urban area are found in structures. So when you saw us first land, before even our trailers got there, we started searching every structure, pretty much from Walker all the way down, and we made it actually all the way down to Eddie Group. Searched every structure along that road we could get into, and we actually even had the police call and get contacts and open up a couple of yards that had closed since we got there so we could actually go in and search because of the habits that we know a child of that age is going to exhibit, like hiding.
We also searched inside those businesses. They opened them up for us, office to office, every space that we could find, pipes, culverts, everything.
It was extremely thorough. And from there, we started, we did Brooks. We did around the fields, we did all the brushy areas we could see, and we started doing some of the waterways leading out. And by the time that happened, it was pretty much ready to get into Halifax's operational period. It does take a while. So they came in, and actually, before I go that far, we did actually have thermal imaging cameras. So they were a camera that fire departments used to look for heat signatures and walls and stuff for structures. So we actually had six of those on site, again, to go through some of the brushy areas and stuff to get really thorough into like brush piles and stuff like that, someplace where he might have crawled in. That with searcher just might not have seen, especially with the darker clothing and that. So we actually had all of these areas, all of this brush, all eliminated, all by thermal imaging camera as well the first night. So when Halifax came in the next morning and they took over, they redid most of this. They did hasty searching. They brought in drones. I know they did both of the rivers with the drone, then they headed over to Main River. You guys saw they had the camera down in the waters and everything else. They brought in the diving team to Trevor Brook. They had, what else did they have there?
We still had Swiftwater Rescue.
The Swiftwater
well, Wednesday when we first...
We started with them, but they were back helping with Halifax the next day.
Yeah.
So from that point with the discussion that was had, the decision was to kind of just switch gears. So for the next 3 days when we were there... So,
I just want to... It was a Thursday night that we moved to a changed phases from... Search to
Thursday night, yeah.
Recovery. On Friday morning, we had a DNR helicopter.
That's what I'm bringing up.
We'd be showing up there right now, basically.
So
what we did.
When Friday morning we went up in the helicopter, we covered every nook, every cranny, and everything we could get. Clear from right over the house. If you're wondering, that's our command post. That's your the residency on KP. The last known position is what we call. So in the helicopter, Rob was there, Tom and myself were both up in the helicopter as well with the pilot. We covered every nook and cranny all the way to the village that we could with the helicopter that day as well. And then by 5 p.m. that night, we actually had search teams back on site, which is when we started doing our extensive riverbank search. So we had search teams for the next 3 days, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, and we covered every riverbank from the other side of the railroad bridge all the way down to 102. And then Sunday, we actually covered, by the way, it's not even on the map.
Sorry, did we miss Thursday?
No, Thursday was the drone.
Wednesday to Friday.
Thursday was the drone. Friday.
The drones, they researched a lot of this area. They did the drones, they had their search teams in ground on foot. They had the dive team there. So they had a lot of the specialty resources yeah. there on Thursday.
I'll just comment it. All 3 days the helicopter was here.
Yes.
So Wednesday afternoon, our response was we were on within minutes of the call initially. We reached out to our policing partners over across the river, the RCP, they deployed resources, and our canine team searched the area. We had a Truro fire out on the river, watching the river, caught up with fires and relieved them, and they stayed there till dark. Watching the river.
We rolled in at around 4.
Yeah.
4 o'clock that day.
That was outside of 4. A non-intrusive message went out through social media advising of the lost child in the area. And as once that went out, you could see a lot of town residents, everybody was in that area to look at the child. So yeah, all 3 days of the helicopter there. Wednesday afternoon, Thursday morning. And about 5 hours of flight time
Friday.
And that was what that well it was. That was the track from Fridays.
It was down Maitland Way.
That was Friday.
The pilot was fantastic. In some cases we were that low that we could have sent right out of the helicopter up to the area.
Yeah. And if there had been a need to, yes. It would have.
Yes.
He would have landed so we could get a look if we had the cause to actually go and investigate something further.
And we actually responded to a few radio calls of things spotted too as well with the helicopter, yeah. Check them all out, and that yeah. stuff. We searched high and low.
So, and again, we did the riverbanks. We also had observation points set up every day when the tide came in to watch the waters and that, make sure there was nothing in the water. And then yesterday, we probably heard we were back at Leverbrook looking in the water hole again. We actually had, because one of the areas we weren't completely satisfied with was the area behind Stanfield's because it's fenced. So the teams, and it's very steep, the teams were having troubles getting in there. We actually had Truro Fire wash that entire thing in the water yesterday with pipe bolts checking. So that entire area was completely covered off again yesterday.
Any questions?
Yeah, many questions I'm probably never have answers for.
And we feel the the same way.
Yeah. Oh, yes. Oh, I'm sure. I'm sure you do.
So just to give you an overall idea, we had a total of 119 cat scans out. And this is going to look like a whole bunch of squiggly lines when it loads slowly. So that is the tracks from the search teams that were out looking.
So each team has a GPS and it's all recorded where they look? That's,
yeah.
That's what that is.
So even if we just come over here and zoom in.
May I ask, why wouldn't you guys start at the point he was missing at the river? And then why wasn't it moved out close to the bay and worked their way in right away?
We did do that, actually.
Okay.
We did do that on the ground first. Helicopter, and that's how the organization works together, and that's how we actually did exactly that. That's why that LKP, that's our last known position, that's exactly where we work from outwards. And we do
we work outwards, so there's areas right around that we have to cover first. But then, as soon as we finish with this area, the next teams that went to the 102 to start working their way back. So it's like the percentage. So just from this, the distance traveled, 75% of all the children lost in this category are found within 800 meters of that, of the last known position. So that's why we focus so closely in, because that's the highest probability area. So that's the best chance we have. But as soon as we covered that area, we were out all the way to the 102 working our way in, and the helicopter had already been flying that, even from day one.
Excuse me, in that equation that you just mentioned, about 75%,
yeah.
Sir, does that include if indeed he went in water and the speed of the...
That's overall. The find location breaks it down to whether they're found in structures or on roads or in waterways. So when I look for an urban area, 3% are found in water. My big concern was that 56, because children of that range are known for hiding. That was my first biggest concern, was to get those structures done first. And then the next thing we went to was the waterways.
Danger areas we started straight away.
I'm sorry, the waterways.
Danger areas, as we call them, like hot red areas that we classify them as, where there's a danger to the child and that's our next priority.
Within the first hour of us on site, there was a fire department sitting down where the old palace or hotel to look off was, watching the water.
Yeah, and
they were there.
Before they were on site, I was in the helicopter, right? Flying that river.
Yeah.
Before these guys got here. So once we reached out to Shuby, the helicopter's here fairly quick, and we jumped in and took over.
So, I mean, there's absolutely no sign of him being in the water.
Other than that somebody could have thrown in
boots.
Absolutely.
Which is...
So why wasn't an Amber Alert?
Where,
like, they should make a new law, like Dylan's law, where anyone under 10, that Amber Alert really should go out just in case, because it's a possibility. I mean, it's a rare occasion, but this is a rare occasion.
Yeah, so I'll talk on the Amber Alert right quick. So I did call the province right away about 2 o'clock or so on Wednesday, told them what we had on the go. We didn't have any real evidence to suggest abduction or foul play right off the jump. So that isn't going to trigger the Amber Alert. But what they said they would do is put out a non-intrusive alert. So instead of going to everybody's cell phones, it goes out to all the media platforms and then all the government social media. That's about the best they could do on the Amber Alert, right? Now, if we had somebody say, yeah, there was a suspicious vehicle there just minutes before he was gone, then it would have been an Amber Alert scenario. But unfortunately, we didn't have that, right?
There was a suspicious guy with a duffel bag.
Yeah, we checked that out. So it was his laundry, right? So, but there was nothing there to trigger the Amber Alert at 2 o'clock in the afternoon. But what you didn't see us do is we focused on the search, because that's the most obvious.
Yes.
But right from the jump, we've been doing... I'm not going to say a criminal investigation, but a missing persons investigation. So our detective section, they're not there searching visibly. They were there originally to help right away so we could flood the area, but they've been doing some background stuff, right? And that's the stuff the public doesn't see. So we're not putting all our eggs...
That's something that we even heard about.
Right, but that's stuff we don't put all our eggs in one basket. So they've been looking at video, going and collecting video at different businesses, canvassing areas, doing all that stuff, and that still hasn't really yielded anything to suspect foul play. continue to go now, because these guys have put in the time and the effort. You've seen how extensive the search has been.
Oh, yeah.
There's not a whole lot left on that front for us to do. They do have a couple of things they want to try this week, and they'll get to that in a minute to let you know what that is. But our efforts now are going to focus solely on the missing persons file. We've been focusing on both. The majority has been on the search, because we want to find Dylan.
Oh, yeah.
This is now where the reality where we're at. I don't know what else physically these folks can do on the search front, so now we've got to ramp up our missing persons file a little bit more, right? So not to say we haven't been doing both, because we have, but we've exhausted this side, unfortunately, right at this point in time. So now we need to continue on with the missing persons piece and a couple other little tricks that they have that they want to try.
Okay.
So I don't know if that addresses that piece, but that's where we're at, right? So we have been doing those things just behind the scenes, right?
Okay, so let's introduce what we're looking at. We've done this, we've searched. Our teams are very involved in this right now, so we're trying to think outside the box. And like you guys, we have a question. Well, if he was in the water, where'd he go? So we've got a little trick we're going to try. Never been done before, but we're going to try it. We're getting a mannequin made, simulating size and that stuff. We're going to dress it as close to the clothing as we can get. We're going to release it in the creek. We're putting an RF radio frequency tracker on it. We're going to station antennas all the way along the river as far as we can. And we're going to track it and see if that's going to answer some questions for us.
So they're going to wait until the tide conditions are similar to the world last Wednesday, and they're going to try to simulate the environmental conditions the best they can without being exact, right? Mm-hmm. So that's why they're not jumping out doing it today, because that tidal condition is not quite what they needed to be. So they're hoping, maybe
exactly, and we're hoping we're going to get in tomorrow, and we're hoping to do it three times. That way we can use all the variables into it. Hopefully that's going to answer some questions for you folks as well as for us and that stuff as well.
Okay.
It's outside the box, so everybody thinks, you know.
So we've reached out to Bedford Institute of Oceanography down in Dartmouth, down Bedford, and we also reached out to the UFO Newfoundland for, they do these modeling for charge, so if you had size, weight, all that kind of thing. The big factor is the tidal water. Right, that's the dynamic that other places don't have.
Mm-hmm.
So their modeling, their calculations couldn't really pinpoint a potential area to look out in the bay.
They kind of told us the modeling they do is more for open ocean, like for open water. But that tidal war, like Rob said, it's such an anomaly. You don't have it anywhere else really.
It's also one thing we were just.
So it makes it a little bit more difficult for the modeling to be accurate. But we're still doing that. Right?
So we flew that Friday. It was like the water was just gone. At 4 o'clock, it's pretty even with the dike. You know, that's the change in the water. That's there.
And unfortunately, the night he went missing was a full moon. So the tidal war was at its max. You could hear it roaring down the river out there at 11 o'clock at night. And it was about a 2.5 foot high wall of water that came down that river.
The other avenue we're looking at maybe getting a camera in a few of the deep spots. We're trying to get with the current and everything, we're trying to see if we can see it.
Do you think it's a possibility still hung up under the water? You've had divers and cameras.
There's spots that the divers
didn't go. And the water wasn't that high at that moment in time, so it's just crazy.
The water was actually quite high. The tidal war wasn't. The tidal war came in. I can't remember the exact time, but Tom was there the first night down by the river, the Lever Brook, and the water was considerably higher even than it was 2 days later.
Wednesday night, Tom and I were both, and the Truro Fire guys were in the water, most of them my height, and they were up to their chest in that brook, right, and in certain spots in that brook, right, because the brook kind of runs, and it dips, it has some low spots, and I'm telling you, like, those guys were up to their, like, it was all they could do to stand up, and it was running that high, and they were up to their chest, right,
and it was very strong.
It was.
Yeah. Now it's not like that today because the water flow to that creek's been cut off.
So the town has up the water treatment facility up at the top of Young Street. This Lever Brook runs all the way up through Victoria Park and all the way through, right? So yesterday afternoon, the engineer put a stopper in the brook way up by the water treatment plant. He kind of opened the stopper so it kind of slows the water flow down to the brook. So that was for yesterday. We put that in place so we could use the underwater camera and really took the water down. It's probably ankle height. So anyway, we got we're able to get that underwater camera in some spots that were inaccessible because of the height of the water. So he's got that. We're going to keep that stopper in place overnight tonight. And then if they go to do their experiment Wednesday afternoon, late in the afternoon, he's going to open that stopper up, and it should force a whole bunch of water in that rock and try to raise the height again to stimulate the conditions that were last Wednesday. So that's what we're a whole lot of things going on that are outside of the scope of normal search stuff, right? So we're not leaving anything unturned.
No, man, it's just all a matter of trying to get the timings right, get all the resources in the right spots at the right time to do that.
Yeah.
And our teams are there. If we find anything, we'll be back later. Yeah.
They're sitting there with their phones in their hands waiting to be called back.
So what makes you so positive, with all due respect, what makes you so positive he's still in this vicinity, this area, if indeed he was in the water? Like, could he have not just,
it's not so much that that's the assumption. The point is this, we're searching an area that we're capable of searching. We can't search the entire bay, unfortunately. It's just, for resources and stuff, it's just impossible. Like, unfortunately, as much as we want to.
And some of those in the brook where we found the first boot, I mean, there's a lot of erosion in that brook because of the water pressure and stuff over here. And there's all these areas underneath the ground so if this is the ground, underneath is all from the water rushing in there. And when we found that first boot, there was a grocery cart, a full-size grocery cart in the water that had pulled out. Like, that's how deep that cavern was, right? It was a grocery cart in there. They pulled out. And that's where the first boot was located, right? So there's a few of those types of spots. Now, we searched with an underwater camera, and the divers did the best they could searching it, right? They were in there looking around, but it's still deep. It's hard to see. So even yesterday when the water was low, we put that underwater camera back in there, right? So the flow of that brook coming down, is it possible lodged in there somewhere? Who knows, but we want to make sure we know for sure, right? Because that's where it's found, right? We haven't found any other article of clothing in that water other than right? So is it possible? We want to make sure we know for sure. So we can rule out and say, hey, he's not under there anywhere, right? That's kind of where we're at. So we spent a lot of resources in that area because close to the last known location that he was seen, and we found evidence to suggest that he could have been in that water, body of water. And the way that brook is, there are some hollows, right? There are some spots. So we just want to make sure we absolutely rule all that out. Amy's statistic as well says most lost children that size and age are typically found very close to the home. Right? So that's why we're really
there. What is
there.
The other 25% say?
Well,
that's why we looked all over the other places. Yeah. Right?
Well, 56%, just to read you the stats, 50% are found in, 56 is structure, 12 is road, 7 is linear, so trails or, a deer trail or something like that, 4% is drainage, 3% are in water, 3% are in scrub, 8 in woods and 8 in field. So it gives you a breakdown of where the different areas that could be found.
That document is an evidence-based document based on cases and that stuff. And actually, in Canada, Nova Scotia.
Well, some of those, in the brook where we found the first boot, I mean, there's a lot of erosion in that brook because of the water pressure and stuff over here. And there's all these areas underneath the ground that, so if this is the ground, first boot is located, right? So there's a few of those types of spots. Now, we searched with an underwater camera, and the divers did the best they could searching it, right? They were in there looking around, but it's still deep, and it's hard to see. So even yesterday, when the water was low,